Out of the wilderness, God called forth a new message of hope.
God is calling us to something new now.
Out of the earth waters, God brought forth life.
God is bringing us to new life now.
Out of death, God gave us eternal life.
God has sent us Jesus Christ, so that we may all live.
Come, worship Christ.
Chapter 19, verses 1 through 7, Paul in Ephesus. They replied, "We've not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "What baptism did you receive?" They answered, "John's baptism." Paul explained, "John baptized with the baptism by which people showed they were changing their hearts and minds. It was a baptism that told people about the one who was coming after him, John. This is the one in whom they were to believe. This one is Jesus." After they listened to Paul, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came into them, and they began speaking other languages and prophesying. Altogether, there were about 12 people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel lesson comes from the book of Mark, the first chapter, beginning with the fourth verse. Listen now to the word of the Lord. John the Baptist was in the wilderness calling for people to be baptized, to show that they were changing their lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were baptized by John as they confessed their sins. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One stronger than I am is coming after me. I am not even worthy to bend over and loosen the strap of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. While he was coming up out of the water, Jesus saw heaven splitting open and the Spirit like a dove coming down on him. And there was a voice from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please turn to a neighbor on one side and say, "Neighbor, oh neighbor.
Neighbor, oh neighbor.
What captivates you?
What captivates you?"
Please turn to a neighbor on another side and say, "Neighbor, oh neighbor.
Neighbor, oh neighbor.
What captivates you?
What captivates you?"
Now don't leave me out. Look here and say, "Justin, oh Justin. Please go with me to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Lord, I pray that you would speak through me, perhaps even in spite of me, and let the humble words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. As we begin the season of Epiphany, this Sunday we remember our Lord's baptism. So we want to talk about baptism today. In the life of the church, we talk about baptism as initiation into the church. We talk about how through baptism, Christians are born. So I want to tell a story of my baptism, a bit of a testimony, a story of my conversion, if you will. And I want to begin that by giving you a little bit of background. I've shared some of this with you before. I grew up in North Houston, and my family moved there when I was a baby. They moved to a community that was there because of, well, everyday segregation. See, most minority people could not afford to live in that community, in part because they couldn't get loans to live in that community. However, my dad worked for a bank, so he found a way us to be there.
And so I grew up in this community kind of in between worlds in various ways. Yet I grew up always wanting and aspiring to the dreams of that community. I grew up wanting what's called a charmed life. A life I perceived that some people around me had. Never seeming to have to worry about money, always seeming to have everything they need, being able to go to good schools, a life unaffected by danger or difficulty, a charmed life. What does Macbeth say to Macduff? You're wasting your time trying to wound me. You might as well try to stab the air with your sword. Go fight someone who can be harmed. I lead a charmed life. I wanted to lead a charmed life, and I thought the best way to do this was to be powerful. As a child who grew up largely in the 80s, that translated to wealth and political influence. Being smart would certainly help. Smart is a good thing. We hold that to be treasured in this community. So being smart would have helped, certainly. But the kind of stable genius that I was looking for was the genius of business and politics that would lead to wealth and power. I'd seen that kind of genius. I'd seen that kind of influence work. But I didn't want this power simply for myself. I had this sense, in part placed in me because of the example of my parents, of this social awareness. And so I wanted the power to be able to help other people. In our culture, it's easy when you want to have that kind of power to grasp for those golden keys, to try to grasp Tolkien's Ring of Power or J.K. Rowling's Elder Wand, some kind of magic that can have us power, give us power to help others and perhaps even help ourselves. Along this journey, I also began to read the scriptures. In middle school, I found my family's Bible, which was about the size of this Bible here. Good King James Version, or King Jimmy, if you spent enough time with it. So I read from this King James Version. I began reading the Gospels. And I worked my way through the New Testament, and then I began with the Gospels again and worked my way through the New Testament, and then I began with Genesis and worked my way through the Bible. Began this in 6th or 7th grade. And somewhere in the midst of this journey, these words from Jesus' baptism caught me. Now, something about this testimony of Scripture caught me, and I determined that if I wanted to see the power to change the world, I need to be with God, because only God had the power to change the world. This was a conversion moment for me. Aspiring to one kind of power and influence, kind of a charmed life, and then realizing that the only life I wanted to live was a life in God, a life in the church with this power of the Holy Spirit flowing through me, working in me, so that I could be the kind of person God wanted me to be, and could see the kind of new life God wanted to see in the world. So I remember coming downstairs one day and approaching my father and saying, I need to be baptized. I was at that time attending a Methodist church with my friends, and my family were members of a Baptist church, and my father said, sure, you can be baptized, but it's got to be in the Baptist church. And so we went there to Wheeler Avenue Baptist Church, and I put on a white gown, kind of like the robe I'm wearing today, and there was a baptistry kind of up in the back of the chancel area. Some of you have seen this, know this scene very well. It was an evening service, and I remember there was an elder gentleman that met with each of those of us who were being baptized. We were all children and youth, and he had conversation with each of us one-on-one and talked to us about the importance of baptism. I actually don't remember a word he said, but I remember that it was important enough for him to invest his time to share that with me. Then I went into the baptistry with the Reverend Dr. William Lawson, who was the pastor of the church at that time. And as the congregation sang, wade in the water in the background, I was baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Never forget it. Changed my life forever. Because baptism gave me not only a new life in Christ, but it gave me a new family. Where I struggled in between these kinds of worlds, all of a sudden this new world, this new family was opened up in Christ. See, we were all now pinned together, no matter what our differences might be. Through baptism, we are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation, the liturgy says. And a mighty act of salvation is a formation of this community of kinship that we experience. In Christ, we develop a new culture. There's a different politics. Power comes from a different place, and it extends into the world differently as well. All this through baptism. I want to invite you to grab your hymnals and turn to page 34. Just for a moment. Turn to page 34. Now, this is part of our baptismal covenant, where we offer these vows. In the early church, did you know, they used to call this the little or the minor exorcism. Did you know that? That's your Jeopardy answer for the day. The little or minor exorcism, minor meaning it doesn't quite, they're not going to make a movie out of it. So it's not a major one. It's a minor one. And so we say these vows. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin, and then we say, we do. You accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves, and we say, we do. You confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races. And we say, we do. This mini exorcism, this pushing away of the darkness. Again, this is not exorcism in a fantastical sense. The church has understood that to be that it's a regular part of its job is to expel darkness in individual lives and in the life of the world. And we do this by allowing the Holy Spirit to have free reign in our lives and by allowing that light to shine. We emerge from these baptismal waters as spirit-filled people and inhabiting inspirited bodies. And so, my brothers and sisters, as we remember the baptism of our Lord, as we journey through this week in remembrance, remember that the church is born through water and the Spirit. There's something about what Jesus says, or what God says to Jesus as he emerges from the waters. As we're born in water and the Spirit, we hear the voice of God saying even to us, "You are my beloved child, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness." Some translations say, "In you I am well pleased." Another way to translate the Greek might be to say, "In you I find delight." We emerge from these baptismal waters hearing the voice of the Lord saying, "In you I find delight." It is this love that wraps us up. It's this love that captivates us. Colossians 1:3 says, "He rescued you from the control of darkness and transferred you into the kingdom of the Son he loves." So my challenge for you this week, as you think about your baptism, or you think about the baptism you are being prepared for, is that every time you encounter water, drink from a fountain, water from the rain or snow, water from the shower, that you would think about your baptism and be thankful. And my prayer for us is that we would know that God delights in us, that you would know that God delights in you, and that you would simply be captivated by that love. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. which you have redeemed. Renew in us the gifts of your Spirit and the call to Christian discipleship. Where history and heresy have divided us, make us one in the baptism we share. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the peoples you have created. Give to the leaders of all nations the wisdom to know what is good. Where people are poor and hungry, provide justice and daily bread. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the loved ones you have given us, for Johnson Beasley and Francis Johnson, for Nora Lee and her family. Bless our families, friends, and neighbors. Keep them safe from trouble and danger. Where there is sorrow, sickness, or suffering, send your Spirit of comfort and healing. Lord, in your mercy. All this we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus, whose voice is our strength and salvation, whose breath is the Spirit of peace. Amen.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
We invite our ushers to come forward as we give of our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with God and with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God,
we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not fulfilled you. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard our community. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The good news is that Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
bread which we break, to share in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks, to share in the blood of Christ. You may be seated. To those who will be assisting the serving of communion, please come forward. As we move forward to feast at the table today, we'll also be having a moment of baptismal remembrance. So as you'll come through the center aisle, Pastor Toby and me will be there. And we will invite you to remember your baptism in this way. You could either extend your hand and have the sign of the cross placed on your hand, or either that or on your forehead. If you're still in a time of preparation for baptism, you may come forward to receive a blessing. And so we'll come in this time of baptismal renewal, and then we will move to feast at the table. The table has been prepared. Won't you come to Christ's table of grace?
Thank you.
Please stand with me now as we conclude our time of remembrance. And what I want us to do is, so this position that you'll often see someone who's presiding at the table, I think it's called the Aaron's position. It's a fancy church word for we lift up our hands, palms facing upward. It's a posture of reception, receiving the Spirit. So I want to encourage us all to do that. Methodists need to be encouraged liturgically to lift hands. And so I encourage us all to do that and receive now these words. May God's Holy Spirit continue to work within you, that being born by water and the Spirit, you may be found to be faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, that walk in the way that leads to life eternal. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we prepare to sing our closing hymn, if there are those who would like to come forward to dedicate or rededicate their life to Christ, to join with this congregation, or to come for prayer, please join Pastor Toby and me in front of the chancel. We'd be happy to receive you. The peace of Christ be with you.
Amen.